Good morning, everyone. My name is Eryn. I'm in Sarah Knoll's lab, and my thesis research will compare catchment scale aquatic habitat modeling techniques for threatened fish in the Bear River watershed. So accurate habitat modeling is important. We have to know where wildlife are in order to know what habitat is both important to them and detrimental to them. Simple, repeatable methods of modeling habitat are desirable because we know that environmental objectives, particularly habitat objectives, often take the back burner in water management planning. Most habitat modeling since it started in the 60s or so has been done at the reach scale or over the span of a few hundred meters with site-specific data. The focus of this research is to do just as adequate a job at the catchment scale, so a larger spatial scale that can be more easily implemented into those management plans. There are many approaches to doing so at the landscape scale, but the accuracy of these methods have not been compared, and so that's where I fit into the picture. My research goal is to determine if there's a difference in accuracy between catchment scale aquatic habitat modeling techniques, and I will address this goal with the following two questions. What landscape variables have the most influence on both bonneville cutthroat trout and bluehead sucker distribution in the Bear River watershed, and how accurate are these models used in predicting their presence? So let's talk about how we're going to get there. First, to address the first question there, which is what variables most influence both species, I will identify some potential landscape predictors that could influence them both, and then feed those predictors into a geospatial model that I will be creating using MaxEnt, and compare those predictions to existing habitat threshold model and a hydraulic model. To answer the second question, I will validate all three of the models and then use statistical analysis to compare the relative accuracies of all of the modeling procedures to see if there is a significant difference, and if so, if there is a better option for doing so at the landscape scale. So where are we doing this? The Bear River watershed, we are standing in it right now. It spans 19,000 square kilometers on the corner between Utah, Wyoming, and Idaho. The Bear River originates in the Uintas in the northeast corner of Utah. It travels into Wyoming, goes back into Utah, back into Wyoming, up over into Idaho, and then terminates in the Great Salt Lake. The Bear River is the single largest contributor to the Great Salt Lake, which we know is decreasing in size every year. And the Bear River watershed is morphologically unique in that it is the largest watershed in America that does not terminate in an ocean. But despite these unique morphological characteristics, the Bear River watershed is very indicative of other Western watersheds, and it is dominated by a lot of competing land uses. And so all of these land uses in turn compete for the limited water resources here in the watershed. All of this in the West is exacerbated by the struggles of adapting to climate change and reduced water quantity. So while we humans are adapting to using all of these different land uses in the watershed, we also have these fish that we need to take care of here that are endemic and sometimes threatened in their continued existence. So the two species of interest for these modeling efforts will be bonneville cutthroat trout and bluehead sucker. Both of these species are listed as species of greatest conservation need in both Utah and Wyoming, though not currently in Idaho. So it is again clear that the transboundary nature of this river makes cohesive management difficult. Bonneville cutthroat trout, when you think of trout habitat, you think of the need for cold and clean water. Bluehead sucker are typically thought to have a more tolerable range of habitat requirements, though they do prefer these same habitat conditions that the trout do to complete certain stages of their life cycle. Habitat modeling in the past has been really focused on salmonids like bonneville cutthroat trout. So the fact that we're going to be doing this process for bluehead sucker, which has been called a non-charismatic species in the past, is both unique and will be interesting to reveal their habitat requirements at the landscape scale. So now that you know a little bit about the people that we're working with here, let's talk a little bit about the models that I will be comparing. So disclaimer to start, all of the variables that are going into each of these different models kind of vary at the scale of the inputs that are required to build them. So to start at the smallest point, I have a hydraulic model. Hydraulic models are typically built for the reach scale, so short, couple hundred meters. They are modeled, they are created by taking measurements at cross sections to model for velocity and depth, typically. These measurements are assumed to be uniform in between measurement points. And so hydraulic models, generally speaking, are influenced mostly by channel morphology and surface flow. The unique piece of this hydraulic model that we will be using to compare is that it is targeted at the lower Bear Basin, the water management lower Bear Basin, which takes up about a third of the watershed. So it's much coarser in resolution, much larger spatial extent. And rather than considering velocity and depth, this model considers depth and temperature as its variables. So taking out of stream conditions and zooming out to kind of greater physical conditions, the habitat threshold model that will be used to compare is created by Greg Goodrum and Sarah Noll in my lab in 2020. And this is a variant of a habitat suitability model. Habitat suitability models take all kinds of variable inputs and rely on preference functions to then aggregate the influence of different environmental conditions to determine habitat suitability at a site. So this is a representation of a stream network, for instance. And the difference with this habitat threshold model is it takes the point where habitat would be suitable or unsuitable for each of these variables. And this model incorporates stream gradient, stream discharge, and water temperature, and aggregates the suitable to unsuitable point to create that map shown previously of, it was developed for the whole state of Utah, but reach-wide suitable, unsuitable land. And so finally, I will be creating a landscape geospatial model, zoom out even further, and let's talk about a little bit about what that is, since that's where I'll be spending most of my time, at least for now. What are geospatial models? Let's start there. When you think of the word geospatial, you think of geographic information systems or GIS. You think of large scale publicly available data. You think of like DEMs, for instance. None of this is wrong. Geospatial models use all of these readily available environmental data that you can find, and you can dump as many into it as you want. And you combine that with presence, absence, species occurrence data, put all of those things together into an algorithm, and it will give you a predictive distribution of your species occurrence over a large landscape scale. These are advantageous for land managers to use because of the open source data availability and because they're relatively easy to create. Another perk of using geospatial models is if a sort of data is unavailable, you can use something else to stand in its place or a proxy for it. So in this image on the right, I have an image showing the relationship between elevation and temperature. So if I were unable to have climatic data for my species of interest or my study unit, but I know that temperature is an important feature in the Bear River watershed, I could use elevation potentially to stand in its place and get it a similar influence. So there are a lot of these different kinds of geospatial models. And why am I going to be using Maxent? What is Maxent? Maxent stands for maximum entropy modeling. It models species distribution by comparing the probability of different environmental, the combination of different environmental covariates at the point of species occurrence to the probability of different variable in combinations across the whole study unit. This has been heavily used in fish habitat modeling, and it is geared to work with presence-only data, which is what I have at my disposal. A lot of geospatial models are geared to work with absence data as well. Maxent cooperates with GIS, so I'll be able to map this output, which will be useful. It's open source, which is another big perk, and it has built-in regularization techniques, which will tell me the relative influence of all of the variables that I decide to put into it, decide which ones are important, and then create the ultimate model using only those. So it does the work for me. That's a great perk. The prevalence assumption is something to be aware of. It's not really a con. So what that is it assumes for all of the area that it determines to be suitable, that the species that I am modeling take up half of that space. This is not really a fair assumption, especially when you are working with a species that you know to be rare in occurrence, or if you think there may be a sampling bias with your data. Particularly in our case, bluehead sucker, we know that we have very limited data for that. It's not commonly sampled, so we will likely have to adjust this prevalence assumption downward when modeling bluehead sucker. And I'll show you this distribution here in a minute of what I have at my disposal currently. So now that you know altogether too much about the geospatial model I'll be creating, let's move on to talking about how we're going to validate all three of these models. So what is model validation and why do we do it? Basically, it boils down to two things. We want to ensure that the models are performing as we expect them to. It gives us an opportunity to identify errors and correct them. It also gives us a relative indicator of the accuracy of the model's performance. And from here, you can potentially decide if it could be transferable to other places, which is what modeling efforts should be geared towards doing, not just one site, but useful in other areas. Sort of disheartening thing about this topic is habitat models are not really frequently validated, and when they are, it's pretty inconsistent. Particularly with geospatial models, you kind of take your publicly available online oriented data and you're just like, it is what it is. Environmental conditions are probably the thing that is most often validated, like stream conditions you can go out and measure. But taking environmental, the model predictions of where species occur and then going out and actually field sampling to see if they're there is pretty uncommon. So how are we going to be doing it? We're going to validate both environmental conditions and habitat suitability by measuring stream conditions along the main stem of the Bear River this summer and taking fish presence data collected from the Utah Division of Wildlife Resources, Idaho Fish and Game, and Wyoming Fish and Game to compare the predicted outputs of the models to where we've actually seen the fish in the field. And so you can see the bluehead sucker points are in blue and they're few and far between for one. And if anyone, by the way, has access to more, I would love to have it for either of these species. Just gonna throw that out there. So moving on, what feeds into this next piece is the statistical analysis. So we will be taking these observed validation points that we have and comparing them to what we've both put into the models and the outputs of the models. So to kind of describe how this will look, we will be using chi-square goodness of fit to do so. In model number one, the occupied area means, let's say fish presence data is projected to be in half of the area, half of my study unit. And the model said, same area. That would be a perfectly performing model. That would be great. In the second instance, we are over predicting where habitat should be. And in the third model, we'd be under predicting. So I don't know how it's going to look yet, but I'm assuming that it's going to be something like this. So after we get these comparative results, the expected significance of this research is as follows. First, we will be predicting fish distribution for both species, which is useful, particularly for bluehead sucker, because it hasn't really been done in the watershed. It is useful for conservation agencies to know where fish are, and also for biologists who have to develop field sampling plans. If we know that there is a super ideal habitat type or habitat area, it might be useful to go out and see if they're actually there, and if not, why not? This research could also contribute to a larger body of research that suggests that large-scale environmental variables do just as well as, if not a better job at predicting species distribution than those site-scale data points that are expensive and time-consuming to collect. And the model outputs, if we determine that there is a more accurate modeling method, these methods could be implemented with conservation planning and water management planning. Again, a simple repeatable method is desirable, and an accurate method obviously is desirable too. And then if nothing else, this work will provide a comparative framework for comparing different modeling techniques, potentially those missed here, additional modeling techniques or comparisons of modeling techniques to compare habitat distribution anywhere, not just in the Bear River watershed. So with that, thank you to my committee, and I'll try my best to answer any questions you have.
So you're going to use elevation as a surrogate for temperature?
I won't be, but it was a great example. Oh. I actually do have climatic data available.
Aaron, you looked at the EPA's National Urban Stream Survey data for fish.
No, I haven't. What should I be looking for there?
Send me an email and I'll send you a link, but you can almost certainly have it.
That would be great.
Question about max now. I'm a little nervous about maximum, but I understand why you're using it. But any of these modeling techniques are sensitive to balance between presence and absence. So for example, for a rare species, you may have 95% absences and only 5% presence. If the model predicts that that species shouldn't be there, it looks really, really good. But what you're mostly interested in is predicting presences. So have you considered ways to adjust for imbalances in presence and absences?
And you can correct me if I'm wrong, because I am certainly not well versed in any of this yet. I think that's what the prevalence assumption does. I think that is sort of how it weights the difference between your presence points and the overall background points. So if you say that of all the area, I think that my available species are only taking up 20% rather than the assumed 50%, that unweights that a little bit. I could be wrong about that.
One of my recent PhD students has published a paper to one of the consumers.
That'd be great. Thank you.
Is there any way to incorporate data on connectivity for fragmentation across the large scale?
There is. So actually, Greg developed some connectivity data for the entire state of Utah that I will be probably having to figure out how to rasterize that data, but that will be one of the parameters I'm using.
Yeah, so building on that scale question, how do you consider biological interactions across the watershed, where you might predict that there's good habitat, but some biological interaction prevents that habitat from being utilized?
I knew somebody was gonna say it. At this point, I don't know that we are going to be considering biological interactions, which is a glaring failing, I'm aware. But this is all with the intention in mind of creating simple and repeatable methods. And so methods getting towards like bioenergetics or modeling primary production get a little more complicated really quickly.
What if you could run your same max end model, but for brown trout or for another invasive species that might prevent some habitat from being realized in across that field?
I will ask if I should do that. that would be interesting, but yeah, we'll see. I'm using an NHD stream network, and so I do think that that includes perennial streams. And so our presence points, if you remember back on that map, I do think that that probably has points on both. And so this is another piece that may not be great, but we are considering that a point of presence at any point in the year means that habitat is suitable for the whole year. Know that that's dangerous, but that's kind of what we have to work with. Where?
Three different models that you're adding together, each one of those has some sort of uncertainty, that uncertainty compounds.
So I'm not adding them together. I'm just comparing them. So I will take the predictions created by the Maxent model, the predictions of the habitat threshold model, and the predictions of the landscape scale hydraulic model, and see how the three perform relative to one another.
So it's all relative to one another?
Yes.
Thank you.